Our next speaker is Dr. William Moore. Will is an assistant professor of radiology who serves in both the neuroradiology and nuclear medicine divisions at UT Southwestern. He earned his medical degree and completed his residency and fellowship training in neuroradiology at UT Southwestern. He also received residency training in nuclear medicine at Vanderbilt University, and his presentation is entitled Appropriate Imaging of Acute Back Pain and Non-Acute Headache.
Okay, so we're going to talk, some of the things I'm going to talk about are going to be a reiteration of the prior speakers, but I'll try and not belabor some of the points and hopefully add some value here. So we're going to talk about, you know, the scope and context of headache and back pain as the other speakers have. We're going to think about whether we need to order a study at all. We'll talk a little bit about the difference between CT and MRI scans, pros and cons of each, and then essentially talk about what specifically we can order and what scenarios. So we all are aware of the unrelenting increase in cost of healthcare, which is more relevant now than ever, leads to a lot of political discussion, of course. Interestingly, imaging has played a central role in this growth, at least historically. And this data is a little bit old, and I'll talk about that in a second. Also interestingly, there's really not a lot of data to support that this increased use of imaging leads to better patient outcomes. Of course, imaging is really important in taking care of some of our patients, but this increase, it's really the jury's still out whether that increase really leads to a lot more better patient outcomes. Of course, there's a host of stakeholders here, and it's a hot topic. So this has led to initiatives by certain organizations to try and lead to evidence-based utilization of those healthcare resources. And one of those initiatives is the Choosing Widely campaign, which is by the American Board of Internal Medicine in partnership with a host of other subspecialty organizations. And basically what they did is they looked at some low-hanging fruit. What are imaging tests that are commonly ordered and frequently don't add a lot of clinical value for patients? And you'll notice here that two targets for this initiative are headache and low back pain and the imaging associated with those conditions. So I only gave you a partial picture of the inherent issue, and it's also been well documented since about 2010. There's actually been a plateau in the use of advanced medical imaging, and actually maybe even a little bit decline. So the reasons for this are probably complex, and there might be financial issues related here, but the bottom line is, I guess maybe we can take a step back and, you know, if we're doing a good job now, give ourselves a pat on the back and don't think about this anymore. Unfortunately, that's not the case. So basically, if you look at specific scenarios like imaging of low back pain, this is data from a large insurer. You'll look at high-value, low back pain image versus low-value, low back pain imaging. And really, if you look at when the advent of the Choosing Widely campaign was, which was at the beginning of 2012, there's really essentially no change in the utilization of lumbar spine imaging in the low-value scenario. So unfortunately, it's not having an effect in this specific scenario. To reiterate this point, this is actual data from an anonymous ACO that basically looked at what proportion of patients actually underwent or were offered conservative therapy prior to engaging in lumbar spine imaging. And you'll notice here that in 90% of cases, they were non-compliant. So they were offered imaging prior to any conservative therapy. So the bottom line here is that we certainly can do better. So back to the clinical things. So again, headaches are very common in the population, and that's one of the reasons why people are interested in this topic and in curbing use. Leads to over 10 million physician visits annually. I'm kind of preaching to the choir because a lot of you primary care doctors are the ones seeing all these patients, so you all know this. And certainly headaches can lead to disability and missed work days and the inherent indirect economic costs related to that. So, what can we say? What does the literature show about the imaging in the setting of headaches? So as Dr. Leston alluded to, it's been pretty well documented that in the setting of migraine headaches with the normal neurologic exam, the yield of neuroimaging is relatively low. And if we can sort of assume that a head CT costs about $400 and an MRI costs $900, which I think are pretty reasonable estimations, the cost of detecting one lesion on neuroimaging would be $100,000 for CT and $225,000 for an MRI. So certainly we can debate about whether that's good or bad or whatever. It's probably what the facts are, at least in this clinical setting. So what are we looking for with imaging when we're talking about headaches? So really we're looking for secondary causes of headaches, like a brain tumor, an AVM, a bleed, something of that nature, versus the primary headache syndromes that were talked about earlier, like migraine headaches, tension headaches, cluster headaches, those sorts of things that don't generally have imaging findings on neuroimaging. So unfortunately, there's not necessarily a straightforward answer, and I don't want to come up here and act like I can talk more eloquently than a subspecialty neurologist, but we sort of talked about that. But the bottom line is that the retrospective data shows that, at least in migraine headaches and in a lot of other chronic headache syndromes, if a patient has a normal neurologic exam, the yield of imaging is going to be low. So who do we want to image? I think we can use the clinical history to sort of help guide us who we're going to have a higher yield of imaging. And we're going to look at those danger signs again, and I think it's worthwhile reiterating those. So patients who have a sudden onset of their headaches, those people who get maximal intensity of their headache in a short period of time, you may be worried about subarachnoid hemorrhage or a bleed. Those are people that you're obviously going to want to image in short order. People with new focal neurologic complaints, say they have a seizure, a new onset aphasia, or an upper motor neuron deficit, those are people that are going to have a much higher yield of imaging, as was mentioned previously. People who get the first or worst headache of their life, a thunderclap type syndrome, you may be worried about subarachnoid hemorrhage. Those are people you may consider sending to the ER, of course, but if you're going to choose to image them, you may want to, we'll talk about that in a second. Demographics play a role here, so the prevalence of headaches is much lower in the very young and the older, so new onset headaches in those patient populations generally are going to have a higher yield of lesion detection. If you have patients that have fever or change in mental status, maybe you're worried about meningitis or an abscess or perhaps an encephalitis, again, yield's going to be higher in those. And then some systemic processes that might be associated with an increased yield of imaging, like being pregnant, having cancer, or being immunocompromised. What about back pain? So again, back pain is really common, as Dr. Bagley mentioned to us. The estimated prevalence of the adult population that has greater than 24 hours of low back pain in the last 3 months is about a quarter of our population. I can attest to this. I'm one of these people right now. It's springtime, you're working in the yard. I see some of you guys out there maybe kind of squiggling in your seats. Some of you guys are probably having some low back pain. So it's not just important to our patients, but it's important to all of us. I also live a sedentary lifestyle as a radiologist, so I definitely have risk factors. It's a leading cause of disability for those under 45, and we've already talked about the indirect costs. So when do we image back pain? So fortunately, there's been work done to this, related to this. There's some nice clinical guidelines published by the American College of Physicians that I'll show you the reference here in a second. The bottom line is that imaging is essentially not indicated in patients with non-specific acute low back pain. Dr. Bagley kind of talked about the natural history of it. It's very favorable. Most patients are going to get better and reach their back to their baseline. The other confounding variables here is that, well, number one, advanced imaging has been shown to not really improve outcome in this clinical context. And furthermore, it might actually be harmful because people who get early imaging are more likely to engage in surgical procedures or other invasive procedures and take on the inherent risks of complications related to those procedures and maybe not get benefit from those procedures. The other issue here is that if you look at just asymptomatic patients and look at the imaging findings related to those asymptomatic patients, disc abnormalities are very, very common, even in the asymptomatic setting. So it brings into the question, what are we actually even telling you guys when we see these imaging findings in the context of acute back pain? An interesting study by Karagi here basically looked at people who, before they had symptoms, looked at their imaging findings on MRI, and then followed them over time when they became symptomatic. And those imaging findings were either the same or improved when they became symptomatic. Again, calling into question what we're actually showing you guys when we do imaging. So again, it really calls into question the utility of lumbar spine MRI, specifically in the acute setting. So when is it warranted to image? I think these three scenarios are good guiding principles here, as was discussed previously. So if you have a patient with severe systemic disease, somebody who has cancer and you're worried about metastases to the spine, somebody with infection or immunocompromise, you're worried about discitis or epidural abscess, those are people that you want to image. If you have a patient that you might think might have an inflammatory spondylitis, like ankylosing spondylitis, and the treatment for those patients is going to be very different than those with nonspecific back pain, those are going to be people that you want to image. If you're worried about a compression fracture, certainly that's something that needs to be evaluated and potentially treated different than routine low back pain. Urgent findings, so if you're dealing with symptoms of cauda equina syndrome, urinary retention, sagittal anesthesia, if you have evidence of objective weakness, those are things that want to be imaged in short order. They may need treatment urgently. And then what about those patients who you've done your due diligence, you've offered them conservative therapy, and they're still symptomatic, which is not uncommon scenario, but certainly those people need to be imaged so that their appropriate treatments can be planned appropriately. So this is a busy slide, but basically it's just showing you kind of some resources that you might pursue. The American College of Physicians published clinical guidelines both on the diagnosis of treatment of low back pain, and more recently in April, evidence-based guidelines on the utilization of non-invasive treatments for low back pain. And this is interesting because it not only reviews some of the more traditional therapies like NSAIDs, avoiding opioids, et cetera, but it also reviews some of the non-traditional therapies like Tai Chi, spinal manipulation, exercise, warmth, those sorts of things. So these are nice resources. This older one has some algorithms that might help you make decisions about your patients. So what about CT versus MRI? So as was mentioned, CT is really good at a couple things. It's good for bony detail, and it's good for excluding acute intracranial hemorrhage. And it has moderate soft tissue contrast, so it can be a useful test in certain scenarios. MRI has better soft tissue contrast, relatively poor bony detail, but it's still pretty good at detecting acute intracranial hemorrhage. One thing I'd like to note out is that non-contrast head CT basically has no contraindications, and it can exclude all acute neurosurgical emergencies. So if you're worried about acute neurosurgical emergency, you're really worried about your patient, you probably should send them to the ER, but if you're going to choose to imaging a non-contrast head CT, we'll usually provide value there. Of course, CT is related to radiation exposure. MRI, assuming no contraindication, has no biological risk that we know of. If you bring contrast into the equation, that changes things a little bit because renal insufficiency is relevant to both CT and MRI contrast. Claustrophobia can be a concern for MRI. There's some patients that, despite any amount of sedation, just cannot tolerate an MRI. And in that case, then you might have to go with a CT, even though it may be not the most optimal test. Again, non-contrast CT has essentially no contraindications. MRI has a host of contraindications. So if you have a patient with a pacer, some other implanted device like a spinal stimulator, if they've had like a metallic foreign body near their orbit or some other critical structure, those can all represent contraindications to MRI. CTs are quick, MRIs take a long time, they're more expensive and less readily available. So what to order? Unfortunately, there's no universal answer. Luckily, the American College of Radiology has published some guidelines with regard to these specific topics. I'll refer you to the appropriateness criteria. It's easy to Google. They're readily available to everybody. And they cover a host of topics, 210 topics to be exact, and 983 different clinical variants. Each one of these summarizes the issues and provides a literature review. And what it does is it provides basically a rating scale for all the different options of tests, ranging from 1 to 9, 9 being usually appropriate, 1 almost never being appropriate. And you'll notice here, for neurologic situations, headache and low back pain represent criteria that they've published. So again, this is kind of the common typical scenario. This is an example of what it looks like on the appropriateness criteria. So you have a patient with chronic headache, no new features in a normal neurologic exam, imaging is usually not indicated. When you do feel like you need to image somebody, MRI is probably the way to go. What about those patients who have chronic headaches, but now they have something new, something different, some neurologic complaint? Assuming no kind of emergent kind of symptomatology, an MRI with and without contrast is usually the way to go unless there's a contraindication. CT if there's a contraindication. So if you have somebody with a thunderclap headache, worst headache of your life, usually you're thinking about subarachnoid hemorrhage, you want to get a non-contrast head CT and a CTA with contrast. Probably should send them to the ER, but if you want to image them, those are the most appropriate studies. This is just a list of all the different variants for headaches that are available, ranging from vertebral dissection to post-traumatic headaches, so it's a nice resource for you guys. What about low back pain? Again, uncomplicated low back pain, no prior management, no red flags. Imaging's not going to be indicated in that scenario. So they failed therapy like we mentioned. This is the common scenario, people with chronic back pain who might be candidates for intervention. You need an MRI without contrast. Contrast really doesn't add too much to the evaluation there. So what about those with systemic diseases? Then you want an MRI with contrast because it might help us look for a tumor or epidural disease. So contrast is going to be helpful in that scenario, assuming no contraindications. And then if you're worried about a compression fracture, you have a lot of different options here, but plain films are usually a good start there. So again, while there's been a plateau of imaging growth, we have some room to improve on here. Healthcare is, of course, a limited resource, and we want to provide the most good to the most patients with the lowest amount of cost and be accountable. We want evidence to guide our decision making, and headaches and low back pain are our targets here.